Thank you. Almighty God, of whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ said: Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. The second is like unto it: Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity and the undivided unity. We will praise and glorify him because he has shown his Lord, be to
everlasting God, who has given unto us thy servants grace by the confession of a true faith to acknowledge the glory of the eternal Trinity and the power of the divine majesty to worship thy unity. We beseech thee that thou wouldst keep us steadfast in this faith and evermore defend us from all adversities, who livest and reignest one God, world without end.
Amen.
Upon his holy hill, for the Lord God.
The Lord be with you.
And with our spirit.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. John.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
Now there was a man of the Pharisees, named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. Jesus answered him, Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born anew, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said to him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born anew. The wind blows where it wills, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know whence it comes or whither it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to thee, O Christ.
Cannot enter the kingdom of God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good morning and happy Trinity Sunday, everyone. It's a big day in the church. I could stand up here and talk about the history of this feast day, or what the Trinity is exactly, which can't be explained, by the way, so why even try? I would be confessing a bunch of heresies, so let's not go down that road. But I'm not going to do that. I feel it's important to focus on certain facts that all Christians should know so they can teach others. So there are 3 points this morning that I would like to make. 3 points. The first point is about the Pharisee Nicodemus. Nicodemus. What a guy. He's a man who's often overlooked, but shouldn't be. Why? Well, because he was one of Jesus' best friends. He was dedicated. After all, he, along with Joseph of Arimathea, they were the only two individuals who went to Jesus' funeral, according to some other written accounts, as well as John 19, verse 39. They were the only two. All of the other disciples scattered. Nicodemus was really a true friend. You see, as a Pharisee and one of the members of the Sanhedrin, Nicodemus had a lot to lose for showing love and support to Jesus. But that didn't stop him. He was there in the background during Jesus' trial and throughout his passion. He attended Jesus' funeral. He was a true friend. It's hard to believe that a Pharisee could be so dedicated to Christ. The reason for this, what hooked Nicodemus into Christian discipleship, was this conversion in today's gospel between him and Jesus concerning being born again. And that's why he was so dedicated. That's what hooked him. The second point I would like to make. What does it mean to be born again? Many post-Reformation modern Christians will tell you it's asking Jesus into our hearts and claiming him as our personal Lord and Savior. Well, I have some issues with that. In fact, Catholicism has issues with that because that's not biblical. Nowhere in Scripture does it say to ask Jesus into our hearts, nor will you find the phrase personal Lord and Savior, because it's not in there. The apostles never taught that, nor did the early church fathers. In fact, that doctrine wasn't even around until fairly recently, mainly revivalist movements in the 19th and 20th centuries. Well, how's that? So again, what does it mean to be born again? Well, it says right in John chapter 3, verse 5, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." What is Jesus talking about? Baptism. Being born again is being baptized, plain and simple. When we're baptized, it's with water and spirit. That's how we're born anew. I'll explain this in a little detail. If you look through biblical history, Old and New Testament, you'll find that God is rather predictable. He does the same thing every time. And every time there's a new beginning, it begins with water and spirit. Every time. Starting with creation. In the beginning, the earth was formless and void, and the water covered the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God hovered over the water. The water and land separated. Then God created a man. He breathed into his nostrils and he was alive. God's first creation coming out of the agency of water and spirit. God eventually decides to start something else new. The Jews referred to Noah as the second Adam. The earth had gotten too sinful, so God decides to start over. He floods the earth and it's once again covered in water. Noah and his family and some animals are safe in the ark. And hovering over the ark is a dove with an olive branch in its mouth. So Noah goes through the water, and there's a dove overhead which represents the Holy Spirit. Peter references this in his first epistle. The first epistle of Peter, chapter 3, verse 20 through 21, to be precise. "When God's patience waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were brought safely through water, baptism, which corresponds to this, now saves you." Ah, but there's more. There's another new beginning. The children of Israel were enslaved in Egypt. When God sends Moses to deliver them with the Passover lamb, they have to go through the Red Sea, or the Sea of Reeds, whichever translation you prefer. They go through the water, and above them, leading the way, is a pillar of fire by night and a pillar of cloud by day, the Holy Spirit over the water. God leads them safely to the other side, and afterwards, he starts the nation of Israel. So every time God starts something, it's with water and spirit. And in Ezekiel chapter 36, beginning on verse 25, it informs us of what the new covenant will look like. It says, "I will sprinkle you with clean water. I will put a new spirit within you." And then Jesus comes along and wants to be baptized by John. He goes into the water, and the Spirit came down on him. Not long after, Nicodemus approaches Jesus, and Jesus tells him that water and Spirit is what makes a person born again. When Ananias was asked by Jesus in a vision to go lay hands on Saul of Tarsus, who was persecuting the Christians at the time, Saul was blinded, and he was laying there in agony and in emotional turmoil. And he was sorry for all the persecution he had been doing, and he was distraught. He had found Christ on the road to Damascus, and he was laying here blinded. And then God asks Ananias to go and lay hands on him and heal him and make him a Christian. So when Ananias went to go do that, did he go up to him, approach Saul of Tarsus laying there, and say, "Saul, do you confess Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior?" No, he didn't do that. What did he say? He said, "Arise and be baptized and wash away your sins." And Saul was born again. This is the importance of baptism. When our Lord washed the feet of the apostles, he said to Peter, "If I do not wash you, you have no share with me." See, Jesus was not worried about how dirty their feet were. He didn't care about the washing of their feet for sanitary purposes. It was something deeper than that. He didn't care about getting dirt and gunk and nastiness off of different parts of their bodies. Same thing when it comes to baptism. Jesus knew that beyond the physical washing and baptism, there was something more, something greater. There was a spiritual washing, a spiritual cleansing. God has been doing it this way since the beginning of time. Once we are baptized, we are made anew by the washing away of our old selves, our original sin, so that one day we may walk beside our Lord in the kingdom of heaven. And now, as children of God, the newly baptized carry out that same tradition of entering into the body of our Lord's holy church. When you're baptized, you become one of the elect. Predestination is a real thing, yes. Not to be confused with the Calvinist doctrine known as double predestination. The belief that only certain people are born as the elect. That's heresy. We don't accept that. No. We become one of the elect once we're baptized. Now, that doesn't mean our salvation is guaranteed, because from that point on, we have to continue following that path of Christ. But it's a Holy Spirit seal that makes us one of his own. Jesus explained to Nicodemus all about the importance of baptism, and he ended it with his famous line, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life." That was the final hook that grabbed Nicodemus. Jesus is the Son, and whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. And baptism is part of believing in Jesus. It's part of our Christian walk. Nicodemus already knew that Jesus was more than just a man and that he was sent from God, but it was this conversation that truly moved him to becoming a faithful follower, a true believer in the Holy Trinity. This all ties in to the third point I'd like to make concerning the Trinity. In order to truly receive a new covenant baptism, it must be in the name of the Trinity. These things all go hand in hand because that's how it was from the beginning. In the beginning was the Word, Jesus. The Spirit of God hovered over the water. God created the heavens and the earth, the Father. And when God said, "Let us make man in our image," he was talking to the other persons of the Trinity. We baptize In the name of the Father, who is our loving Father and the creator of heaven and earth. In the name of the Son, who is Jesus Christ, the final sacrificial lamb of the new and final covenant. And the Holy Spirit, who is among us, guiding us, protecting us, and healing us, supplying us with the grace we need to live. In order to be a Christian, we have to have all three in our lives. We worship all three persons in one God. What does three persons in one God mean? Again, it's a mystery, unable to be comprehended by human mind. We don't know exactly. The point is that we know the functions of each person. We know that each person is 100% God, not one-third of the Godhead, because to confess that would be committing the heresy of partialism. But each person is fully God, worthy of our worship and praise. So, a review of the 3 points. Nicodemus came to Christ through learning about baptism through water and spirit, which is necessary in order to be a Christian. God has been working through the agency of water and spirit from the beginning, so it's the only way to be born again. And lastly, believing and worshiping the Holy Trinity is what sets us apart and makes us holy. After this Mass is over, let's all be like Nicodemus as we go out into the world and proclaim this to everyone so that new disciples can be made. I proclaim all of this to you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Truly and
your sins and are loving charity with your neighbors and intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in His holy ways. Draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort and make your humble confession to Almighty God devout and kneel.
Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Hear what comfortable words our Savior Christ saith unto all who truly turn to Him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. So God loved the world, that He gave His only begotten Son, to the end that all that believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hear also what St. Paul said. This is a true saying and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear also what St. John saith. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Just a few quick announcements. Today we have a guest organist with us. It's Robert Duquesnel. Is that how you pronounce that?
Duquesnel.
Okay, I was almost right. Robert Duquesnel. Well, it's very nice for you to be with us today. Thank you. We truly appreciate this. And you just may be expecting some calls in the future, please. And then next Sunday, June 19th, and the following Sunday, the 26th, we'll have Matthew Poole subbing for us. He's a very talented organist and choir director, so please join me in welcoming him. On June 19th, next week, we are going to have a Corpus Christi procession around the block in honor of Corpus Christi Feast Day, which is on June 16th. It will take place immediately following the 10 a.m. Mass beginning in the parking lot. All hands on deck. If you know anyone who would be happy to come and process with us, assist, because we do need people to carry some things, light things, nothing heavy, but we do need all the help we can get. So definitely bring them along, please. That would be most appreciated. I decided that Sunday school will resume in the fall. Summer is crazy. Busy. A lot of people are they have things going on, sometimes not here, so we'll just do Sunday school, resume it in the fall. All will be well. Are there any anniversaries or birthdays that we may celebrate this morning? The Lord be with you.
Because He has shown His love.
pray, brethren, that this my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Father Almighty.
May the Lord receive the sacrifice of thy hands to the praise and glory of his name, both of our name and that of all of the Holy Church.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
It is
Thy humble servants who celebrate and make here
glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us. And of thy almighty goodness, vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy bodily goodness, mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son Jesus Christ, and through faith in his love, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all the benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls, and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. Remember also, O Lord, thy servants and handmaidens, who have gone before us with the sign of faith and are at rest in the sleep of peace. To these, O Lord, and to all who rest in Christ, we beseech thee to grant a place of refreshment, of light, and of peace. And although we are unworthy, through our manifold sins, to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, and to command these our prayers and supplications, through the ministry of thy holy angels, to be brought up into thy holy tabernacle before the sight of thy divine majesty, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. By whom, and with whom, and in whom, and in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end.
Amen.
Let us pray. And now, as our Savior Christ
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who taketh away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof.
But speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed.
Guide you into all truth.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee for that thou hast vouchsafed to us, who have duly received these holy mysteries, with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and us assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are very members and corporate in the mystical body of thy Son, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs of hope of thy everlasting kingdom, by the merits of his most precious death and passion. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom in thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. Heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, who has called us to a goodly heritage of the faith once delivered unto the apostles, we humbly beseech thee that thou wouldst give us that same zeal of the holy apostles and of our patron Saint Timothy, and at the intercession of Blessed Mary and the Virgin and all the saints, and by the outpouring of thy Holy Ghost, our parish may see its borders extended both in part and mission, and that thy kingdom may be extended to the glory of thy holy name. Through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who livest and reignest with thee in the unity of the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Depart in peace.
Thanks be to God.
The peace of God which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in knowledge and the love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
The beginning of the Holy Gospel according to St. John.
Glory be to you, O Lord.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word was made flesh,
and dwelt among us.
And we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth.
Thanks be to God.
And the word